Welcome to MHM Podcast Network on MovieHouseMemories.com. Podcast for pod people. Our feature presentation begins now.
You're listening to Lunchtime Movie Review from LunchtimeMovieReview.com, and we are the children of the 80s.
Welcome back to another episode of Lunchtime Movie Review, the podcast where we look back at some of our childhood favorites to see if they stand the test of time. I'm Patrick.
I'm Chris.
I'm Shane.
And this week, we're strong to the finish because we ate our spinach. We're reviewing 1980s Popeye with Robin Williams and, unfortunately, Shelley Duvall. But before we get into our film, before we get into our summary of the film, first a word from our sponsor.
This podcast is brought to you by Olive Oyl's Academy for Personal Dating, where ordinary sailors become extraordinary Navy men. Is that large, bloated guy ruining your chances with the ladies? Are you tired of that deformed spinach eater babbling on about his Sweethaven all day while you sit at home eating burgers with your mom? Do you feel a little bit wimpy asking out a girl on Tuesday with the cheesy pickup line today? If you said yes to any of those questions, then let Olive Oyl's Academy for Personal Dating help you. Look, romancing the ladies isn't just about free tax rides, being rich, and buying her family gifts. It's about maturity, integrity, and commitment. Olive Oyl's diverse life experiences can help you learn those principles and nab yourself that special woman. So give us a try. It beats kicking the cat with your mom.
I literally am trying not to laugh when you read those, Chris. I really like your style. It's just funny.
All right, Chris. And in addition to the sponsor, do you have a summary for us?
Yes, if I can find that one in my notes. You may think that 20th Century Fox and Sony Pictures are the kings of fucking up our beloved comic book heroes on the big screen, but it hasn't always been that way. Paramount Pictures has held that crown for nearly 35 years, and this is their story. Popeye the Sailor Man lands one stormy night in the small town of Sweethaven, a short layover in his search for his long-lost Poopdeck Pappy. He is greeted by a greedy taxman who fines him for petty offenses in the name of the Commodore. He even taxed me 45 cents for this very summary. Apparently, there is a writing a terrible summary tax that I did not know about. Popeye ranks a room at the Oyl's Bed and Breakfast where he meets their daughter, Olive, played by an amazing actress with a bright, bright future ahead of her. But for now, she is busy preparing for her wedding to a local brute named Bluto. He is large, and he is hers. Once settled, Popeye heads out to get some food at a seaside dive and is greeted with a cold shoulder by the townsfolk, but they sing him a song about the town, which is nice. After that, we get another song, this time about food, and then Popeye gets in a fight with some customers making fun of his pappy and his speech impediment. That night at the Oyl's home, Olive's big engagement party is held, but before she greets her guests and Bluto, she treats her bridesmaids to a song about Bluto's girth and then tries to hightail it out of town. She stumbles upon Popeye, who is hanging out by himself on the docks because he doesn't fit in with the rest of the people living there. As the two banter on about mindless things, they find a baby in a basket acting as cute as can be. We'll just call him Sweepea. Popeye calls him that too, which is convenient. Meanwhile, back at the Oyl homestead, Bluto grows impatient, and he treats the guests to a song about him being mean as he trashes the Oyl house. Popeye then gets in a fight with him when he and Olive return with the new baby. The next day, in the name of the Commodore, the taxman takes the Oyl's shattered house and all the remaining possessions. To get enough money to pay the taxman, Castor, the Oyl's dim-witted son, decides it's a good idea to fight a traveling boxer that's arrived in town to win back their home. He fails mercilessly as Oxblood Oxheart opens up a can of a whoop-ass on the boy. This pisses off Popeye so much that he doesn't even wait for a song to get in a fight. He steps into the squared circle, ratchets up his massive arm, and knocks the lard ass out. It's during this fight that Olive discovers that Sweepea can predict the future by letting out a little whistle when he hears the correct answer to any question. Wimpy overhears Olive telling Popeye this and manages to take the boy to the races. After he wins a few times, Popeye shows up and treats the gamblers to a song about him being I am what I am. But he doesn't fight anyone at the conclusion of this song. He moves out of the oil house with Sweepy in tow and sets up a loft on the docks. The tax man tries to assess more fees on Popeye, but Popeye pushes him into the water and the townspeople celebrate. As the melee goes on, Bluto forces Wimpy to steal Sweepy and he takes him to the Commodore's boat. The Commodore doesn't care anything about the baby or his gambling gift because he has his own treasure. So Bluto ties up the Commodore and leaves with Sweepy to find the Commodore's hidden treasure. Popeye enters the boat to find that the Commodore is his long-lost Poopdeck Pappy. To prove to the Commodore Popeye is who he says he is, the Commodore forces Popeye to eat spinach. Popeye refuses to eat it and throws a tantrum, just like the Commodore's own lost son used to do. But our happy reunion is going to have to wait. Bluto has now kidnapped Olive too and is on his way to find the hidden treasure. Popeye, the Commodore, Wimpy, the oil family, and pretty much all of Noah's Ark board the Commodore's ship and all set sail to Scab Island. They catch Bluto there in one of the island's grottos and a big fight ensues. Popeye can't overpower Bluto until he is forced to eat spinach, which gives him all the strength he needs to cold cock Bluto and turn the bully yellow. Then Popeye takes out a ridiculous octopus that's attacking Olive from below, and we, the viewers, are treated to one last song as Popeye celebrates with his newly found family. Toot, toot.
I'm a little disappointed, Chris. I thought you were going to sing the summary. It was my impression. I don't know why I thought that. But, you know.
I can't do the Robin Williams stutter or else I would have tried.
All right. Popeye, released on December 12th of 1980, the same day as Stir Crazy and Tess. The same month as 9 to 5, Any Which Way You Can, The Jazz Singer, Altered States, and The First Family. Grossed over $49 million, it was the 12th highest grossing film of 1980, behind The Blue Lagoon, The Blues Brothers, and Ordinary People, the winner of Best Picture that year, and in front of Urban Cowboy, The Shining, which I know Chris is probably going to be surprised that it grossed more than The Shining.
I am surprised on that.
And Seems Like Old Times. This is the heyday of Shelley Duvall, 1980.
I'm actually surprised it did better than Seems Like Old Times, because that seemed like it was a fairly big movie to me.
Yep. All right, Popeye. Originally, we were going to review this last year, long before Shane was a part of the podcast. And unfortunately, tragedy struck and Robin Williams committed suicide. And so we delayed this. Although in the interim, we did end up reviewing Good Morning Vietnam, another Robin Williams film. But I thought we could start by talking about this was Robin Williams' first lead role in a film. And obviously playing a character, very much a cartoon character. What did you guys think of Robin Williams in the film?
You know, I don't think, even to this day, with all the actors I have seen come and go, impressionists and everything, I personally don't think anybody could bring Popeye to life better than the way Robin Williams did it. You know, even his prosthetic arms didn't seem terribly hokey. I mean, on high def, you can tell they're fake. But his mannerisms, his speech, everything, I think he just nailed it perfectly. And his performance to me isn't the weak point of this film.
Yeah, exactly. I think Robin Williams was enthusiastic throughout the whole thing. You know, whatever was going around him, he remained that pinnacle of this character. Him mumbling to himself and, you know, all the little quips to himself with that pipe in his mouth and the arms that he had, that you just would have thought what it might have just been a bit distracting. They weren't. And he just became this character right from the outset.
Yeah, and something you just brought up, I agree with you. Robin Williams is very, very much one of the highlights of this film is, and I like Robin Williams in pretty much any film. I've seen crappy films he's done, and I've really liked his performance in it, even though the film is not very good. But the way he maintains the character and how his characterization of this character is so good throughout the entire film that you become very affectionate of the character. And you mentioned the mumblings. It's funny because I have small children that sometimes I'm watching movies with the sound turned down and I'll have the closed captioning on so I can keep following the story while I'm trying to get someone to go to sleep. But that really helps in this film because he mumbles a lot and you don't catch what he's necessarily saying. But when you have the closed captioning, you're catching, it tells you what he's saying and what he's mumbling half the time is pretty damn funny. And you just slide by it if you're not really paying attention that closely to what's going on. And I think it's one of the most brilliant things about his performance in this particular film.
Exactly, mumbling to himself, and that introduction after he asks for that room for rink instead of rent, he gets led into the house, and there's all the family running around him, and that introduction to Olive Oyl, going up the steps and going into his bedroom, I just thought that was hilarious, and you can't hear everything he's saying. He's almost like an overgrown baby at times, but it just works, and he's in character that complete time.
Yep. For every good actor, there's a bad actor. And in this particular case, this film does have Shelley Duvall, and I've already tipped my hand that I'm not a big Shelley Duvall fan. And although I will admit that she probably physically resembles Olive Oyl better than probably any other actress out there, especially in 1980, what did you guys think of her performance in the film?
Ah, Shelley Duvall. Where do I start? You're right. I mean, it's common knowledge that everyone always says she was born to play Olive Oyl. You know, she screeches a lot and she sings and doesn't really contribute a real lot in my liking of the film, I must say, but she is right for the role. I don't think she's put a foot wrong in that. But I know that she was a big fan of Robert Altman because he used her in a lot of his movies. So
a ton of them, and I don't understand why.
Different in quality.
Yeah, I don't really think there's anything more I can add to it. She's not the best of actresses, but she definitely was born to play this part. I can't think of anybody that I could see in this role. I'm trying to think now, is there anybody? Kristen Wiig, maybe. So, yeah, the character's flat. The part that was written for her is flat. But she was just adequate. That's all I'm going to say.
Okay. Serviceable. She shouldn't sing. She should not sing. Ever. Ever.
I actually... I thought it fit Olive Oyl's character, even though it's off key everything.
Every time she sings, he's large. You know,
it amuses me. I have to admit, I have a thing of affection for her singing it.
A very few people in this cast can be contributed to actually singing good, and I think Shelley Duvall just screeches. As I mentioned, she just screeches this whole film.
Yeah. Well, Robin Williams is not known as a singer, but I do think one of the more touching moments of this film is his little lullaby as he's writing the letter to Sweethaven after Sweethaven has been kidnapped. And he's not a great singer, but I thought he did okay with that. He was able to get through that at a manageable level that I didn't think he embarrassed himself. Some of the lyrics of that song are a little bit like, okay, I'm just going to write a lyric now that rhymes with the last one. But
It helped that he stayed in character.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Immensely.
Yeah, that's coming back to Robin Williams again, staying in complete control of that character from beginning to end.
Now, one of the most impressive things, one of the best things about this film is the set, Sweethaven, that, I saw it as a kid and I just kind of blew it off as what it's just the set piece. But like looking at it now, that is got to have been an expensive set to build next to the water in Malta. And what did you guys think of that?
Oh, elaborate, massive, just really impressive. And because it's all real and on the location. So that water isn't just a soundstage. That's real Malta ocean. And yeah, I think that's where a lot of the money would have went. And because it went so far over budget from what I've read, no wonder Paramount were a little bit worried. But that's every dollar of that amount is obvious in that huge, awesome set.
Yeah, you know, when we reviewed The Adventures of Pluto Nash for number two review, we were talking about the budget, and we're like, where did the money go? We can't see it. It had to have been, you know, actors' salaries. But this one, when you say, where did the money go, you can clearly see that they used every dime. I don't know if wisely is the term because it's so massively over budget, but they used it, and they did put it – they did an effective use of these sets. So I think they were awesome.
And that set still exists to this day. That it is the Popeye Village in Malta, and it is now a tourist attraction that people can go and visit and actually see that, which is kind of weird considering that this film is not well known. You know, it wasn't a big box office smash, but I thought it was interesting that the set still exists today. You can go there and visit it.
Yeah, well, when I was watching it again for this podcast, you look really closely at the details of the sets and even the costumes they're wearing. That's where all the money went. The detail is amazing.
I mean, even the racetrack with the fake horses was beautifully done.
Now, what was interesting about this, watching this and specifically talking about the set, made me think of another Altman film and one that we reviewed on Movie House Memories, Chris's pick of McCabe and Mrs. Miller, because they actually built the town set for that as well. And kind of the elaborate nature of Altman wanting to build a locale, not a soundstage or to adapt something that's already there, to actually build it and put his cast in it around there. You know, and made me think that this film is somewhat a little bit similar. The fact that there's a stranger coming to a small town and his kind of growing acceptance in the town by the other townspeople. Although Popeye doesn't die in the end of this one, of course.
Die in the snow.
And no snow.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah. No snow to be found in Sweethaven. But, you know, what did you think? Specifically, Chris, what did you think? Because I know McCabe is one of your favorite films.
Well, until you just mentioned it, I never really even considered the two comparable. But, yeah, I think you are right. That I think that by building a set like this, you know, it kind of puts everything and everybody in one section. I guess it kind of will force everybody to stay in character. And especially with McCabe and Mrs. Miller, I think it created a great environment that the actors thrived on. I'm not saying that they didn't in Popeye because it's the story where this movie fails. But I do think that, yeah, definitely there are parallels in that. It does work, definitely.
Well, I know that was something that we discussed, if I remember correctly, when we did McCabe on Movie House Memories, that the set became a character in itself. And I very much think that Sweethaven is a character in this, that it's a place I would like to go see. And if I'm ever in Malta, which will never happen, I probably will swing by just to see the Popeye set. I think it's probably pretty interesting to see. Probably going to be surprised how small it is, but it looks at least interesting on the screen.
I think Robert Altman, the late Robert Altman, would have been that old school director that just really did want you to see what he was, the image he had in his head on the screen. And that's why those sets for those two movies in particular were built the way they were.
All right. Now, this film is a musical, and it's been well versed that I am not a fan of musicals. It's interesting the kind of the even adaption of this film is that Paramount had lost the bidding war for the musical Annie, and Robert Evans went and said, "What do we have the rights to make?" And basically to turn that into a movie musical. And Paramount had the rights to make Popeye at the time. And that's how this even came about. Does the fact that this is a musical, does it work? Is it a distraction? What is your take on it?
Well, I think somebody forgot to tell Paramount not to do that is all I could say. As a kid, and even to this day, I didn't care for musicals. And as a little kid, I was pretty much bored by the songs in it. You know, I never saw Annie. I didn't care to see Annie. And so why would I want to see Popeye singing? It didn't add anything to this film. And I don't think it was really necessary. They should have taken the time that they used to write these songs to rewrite the story and make it a stronger theme.
Well, I think a lot of this is the choreography. Like, it's simple at times, but it's elaborate. You know, most of the singing is people walking outside their front doors in big groups, walking down the street.
Or, that opening scene with them singing Sweethaven.
And I don't remember it because I was quite young, but when I first saw Popeye, it was the second feature at a drive-in, and the first movie was Tron. So I went and saw Tron. I must have fallen asleep. And I remember my dad complaining the next day that, oh, Popeye is a musical. I didn't like it at all. So it didn't go down well back then with him, and I don't think a lot of people appreciated it at the time either.
I'm going to I don't think the musical necessarily works as a whole. I don't think musicals work. But there's songs in this film that I think work, and then there's songs that I don't think work. Like the Sweethaven, I think, is a pretty good song. It's kind of introducing the town. The food song, I don't think is necessary. I don't think is necessary. I don't even know what the song is that Shelley Duvall sings first, but she said, "He's large." I mean, that song is horrible and needs to be taken out. But there's other songs that I don't necessarily have a problem with. That I like the "I Am What I Am" song that Popeye at the racetrack, and I think it's when the song is when the musicals work, when the song is advancing the story. When it's just a song for the purposes of song and it's not really advancing the story, that's when I don't really like it, and I think it's just a delay of moving the story along. We just pause for a second so that someone can sing a song, and where Robin Williams is singing that song in the racetrack, it's, you know, he's talking about his frustration and trying to find the kid or trying to find Sweethaven and his kind of being upset with everyone for, you know, using the child for that purpose. But I thought that was a good song because it actually advanced the story along, but most of the other songs don't. And of course there's the Popeye the Sailor song at the end, which of course had to be there, but that one didn't bother me. So I've grown to liked some of the songs when I was a kid. I like pretty much the same songs now. As long as Shelley Duvall's not singing, it's generally going to be okay. But
I've always felt that the Sweethaven song was kind of the unofficial opening to the film, because, you know, the opening was him, you know, just paddling up in his boat and landing in the town. But I felt that Sweethaven was the perfect opening for it. And that's really the only song that I thought fit really well to the film.
Hmm. That whole opening of the town after he gets out of the boat, after he paddles up, is like a highlight, I think, too. But when it comes to the music and the singing, I can't agree with any of the songs being something that I can say that I like. I'm not going to go out and buy the soundtrack. It doesn't involve me, these songs. If it had been a movie without songs, it could have had a different impact on me maybe. But the Harry Nilsson songs that were all written for the film really didn't do it for me.
All right. We've tiptoed around the fact that this is a Robert Altman film, and it's a very different Robert Altman film, although I can point out similarities to McCabe and Mrs. Miller, despite the fact that he brings Shelley Duvall into it again, he's adapting someone else's work, or at least the character, and you don't see a lot of, you see some of the Altman, you know, stereotypes and the things that he does in all his films, but you don't see a lot of it. He kind of plays it straight. What did you think of his direction of this film?
Different. I remember Nashville and, you know, the movies that came after that. His photography, obviously his cinematography is different in this because of the outdoor locations and where they were situated, but it's just different. And can you imagine the drug use that would have been going down during this production with Robert Evans complaining about the over budget? And, you know, things just would have gone mad on this set. So I think he may have had to adapt quite quickly to certain things which were out of his normal filmmaking realm.
Yeah, it was just fine. I mean, I feel like it was almost, I don't know, it was kind of like he did somebody a favor in making this, and so he was kind of distracted because you know, he didn't put his full effort into this. He just kind of made a paycheck off of it. I mean, it wasn't necessarily bad, but it wasn't his most inspired, memorable work.
Okay. I'm not a particular fan of Robert Altman. I like kind of the player, and that's about it. It is what it is. I thought it was an interesting diversion in his career that he took for this particular film, and also being in a musical, although Nashville is somewhat of a musical as well, but it's a full-blown musical. It's not kind of a hybrid like Nashville is.
He made another musical called A Prairie Home Companion.
Oh, I forgot about that in the 90s. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was, as far as I know, the only other musical that he may have done. But yeah, his direction, he might have, like you said, just made this for a paycheck. Who knows? Because it's just definitely hasn't got that Robert Altman signature when you're watching it.
Now, what is your impressions? I always remember this as a box office flop, but then looking through the research, made over $49 million. It made like $60 million worldwide, more than doubled its budget. It was the 12th highest grossing film of 1980. Did you guys think of this as a flop at the time, or even in your memories of it, or did you see this as a hit film?
Well, I always thought it was a flop. You know, I remember Robin Williams always talking about it at times in interviews, saying, you know, he'd wish it had done better or more people had enjoyed it. He appreciated when people gave it, you know, a good comment towards him about the film. And to me, I always thought it was a major flop. And it was always hard to get on VHS or DVD for a long time as well. So I think that kept the interest factor up as well, because people weren't able to watch it.
I've always thought of this film as a disappointment in watching it. I remember before I saw it, I was very excited to see it. I remember while I watched it, the first half I enjoyed, and the second half, I'm like, that's it. And so I've never had a positive view of this film in regards to the story, even before I could articulate why I didn't, what it was I didn't like about it. So it's always been a disappointment. And I say that completely thinking that Robin Williams nailed the part of Popeye, and I don't think you could have done any better. But no, I've never seen this as a box office success. I'm even surprised that it made as much money as you said it did.
Yeah, well, and that's a lot of money considering inflation as well now. I mean, for the box office to make that money, it obviously had a worldwide appeal thanks to the cartoon strip. So maybe that's what pushed the box office up. Definitely wasn't the octopus finale.
Well, did it end up breaking even? I forget what you said for...
It more than doubled its budget.
Okay.
So it was a profitable film for Paramount. It wasn't an extremely profitable film, but it was a profitable film. And it was not just Paramount. It was Paramount and Walt Disney at the time. They made this film together, probably because of the cost overruns. But the distribution, I think Paramount got to release it in the United States, and Walt Disney got to release it overseas. So that was
how... If Disney would make that today, there would be a origin story that would have encompassed about three-quarters of this film.
Probably.
Yeah, probably. Now, we haven't even spoken about the octopus finale. It was abrupt and too silly to be interesting. It didn't thrill me. And Olive, you know, she was meant to be saved by Popeye, and I don't know. Maybe you're going to read about it in that letter coming up.
Yeah.
Well, one of the things that I remember from Robin Williams' interviews is saying that if there was any movie that deserved to have a big budget ending, it was this film. And unfortunately, they had nothing left to do it. And so we got
a rubber octopus.
We got a terrible octopus. So, I mean, he owned up to the fact that I think it disappointed him too. And I think in many ways it haunted him throughout his career, just on a personal level, because I could tell that he enjoyed playing that character immensely too.
Do you think that this movie would be suitable for children now? Would you show it to children now? Do you think they'd be entertained by it? Because it's a tricky one with some of the stuff in it. I don't know if they'd be interested in it.
All right. Well, I will address that. I will go first on whether this stands the test of time, and I will answer that question. As I said, we were going to review this last year. I watched this film last year. When we delayed, I watched it again this year. Both times, my 4-year-old, now 5-year-old son watched the film with me, and he loves Popeye. He likes the music. He likes the octopus. He likes this film. So okay. I think it does, you know, it does still resonate with children. It did not to me as a kid because I wanted more of the cartoon character. And I knew who Robin Williams was. He was Mork. I loved him in Mork and Mindy. And I knew he was in it. And I almost, is that him? Because he's got blonde hair. I see similarities, but I didn't see the actor. And I wanted more of the Mork character. So that was how demented I was in 1980 when I saw this in the theater. But
Popeye never said Nanu.
Never did it once. Not once. But it was a disappointment to me in 1980, but it was not for my son, who doesn't come in with any kind of preconceived notions of who Popeye is. He's never seen a Popeye cartoon or anything like that. He enjoyed the film. He liked the music. He liked everything that went on in the film. So yes, I do think it resonates with children. And because of that, I think it stands the test of time. This was made for kids, and I think it really does. It still appeals to kids. There is some adult humor in it that if you listen, especially with coming from Robin Williams, if you listen to what he's saying,
definitely
that it appeals to the adults as well. So I did not like this as a kid, but I can see where it still stands a test of time now. So I say it stands a test of time. Shane?
Yeah, I have to sit on the fence. I must have fallen asleep when I first saw this at the drive-in, then having watched it again maybe in the theater that same year it was released. I didn't like it then, but rewatching it for this podcast, there's so much about it better than I expected. Robin Williams, I can't take my eyes off him, and those mumblings to himself, as I mentioned earlier, are just hilarious. They're ongoing through the whole thing. I don't hate Shelley Duvall as much as you, Patrick. I think she was made for the role, and although she's not memorable, I still think she does a reasonable enough job to bring this character to life, and the sets and everything about it were okay, but the finale really let me down, and I just don't think it stands the test of time. I don't think I could watch it again.
Chris?
As I said a little bit ago, this film disappointed me as a kid. And it still disappoints me for the same reasons to this day. So I think visually it's outstanding and it's held up well. The songs I didn't care for back then, the songs I don't care for today. Robin Williams' performance has always been awesome. And for those reasons, I am going to say that it stands the test of time. It's just meant to be a disappointing film because they ran out of money. And I wish it wouldn't have been, because this probably would have been one of the best films coming out of the early 80s. But unfortunately, that's the way it turned out.
Now, one of the children couldn't be here, but he has an opinion on Popeye. Jason couldn't be here for this podcast, but he wrote a letter that Chris has and is going to read to us on his opinion on the almighty Popeye.
I can't wait for this.
I wish I could do the Jason impression, but I can't. All right. So Jason's letter. Dear LTMR, long before sailors were a gay euphemism and violent humor a taboo, there was Popeye. Popeye the Sailor Man. The lessons you have taught us: make sure to eat spinach to beat up the fat kid. It's good to smoke. And looks don't matter when you're interested in a woman with the chest of a 7-year-old boy. It's no wonder in the early 80s why Hollywood would want to tap into a generation of kids in order to instill these values. The first thing that Hollywood needed to do was find an actor to play Popeye. With the success of Peter Sellers in The Pink Panther, they were going to find a comedic actor. So they chose Mork. And what a great choice this was. He walked the walk and talked the talk. Plus, do you know how much cocaine he was able to fit into his forearms? With this brilliant casting of Mork and a huge budget to make this classic cartoon into a live-action summer blockbuster, what could possibly go wrong? If you haven't watched this movie already, you know it's a musical, and Shelley Duvall is in it. He put those in caps and many, many exclamation points. This makes my ass want to throw up. Well, I don't want to see his ass throwing up. Yes, that's right. Those two things together make me crap my pants. And now I don't want to crap my pants, but it's scientific, like osmosis. When Shelley Duvall sings, she saturates the air with crap. So much crap that it fills your ears, nose, and mouth with crap. Your body has no choice to push out its own crap to make room for this new, really foul, disgusting, vile, putrid crap that's spewed out of Duvall's mouth, thereby forcing one to soil themselves. The name for this scientific phenomenon is Shelley Duvallian hymenal intestinal trauma, shit for short. Seriously, the songs are bad on their own. They serve no purpose other than trying to get people like Lori to come to the movie. But then you have Shelley Duvall sing. Was Minnie Riperton not available? Oh, wait, she was black. That wouldn't have worked in the early 1980s. Maybe now, since Annie is being remade for a new race, I mean generation. Wait, I'm getting off the point. Shelley Duvall's acting is bad enough. It's like she went to it's like she went to the Kristen Stewart School of Acting. I know timing-wise that doesn't make sense, but who cares now that my pants are filled with corn and peanuts? I don't know what the boy's been eating. Every line she delivers screams, I'm pretending. The only reason she was hired was because she looks like Olive Oyl. What about Elaine from Airplane? She was skinny and could have done it. If all they were looking for was skinny, what about Matt's Winky? It doesn't have boobs either. Just put it in a red dress, clown shoes, and a wig. It's a better actor than Duvall. Sure, it's going to spit out lines, but it would still be more natural than Duvall. And why are people in love with this chick in the town? Is this some sort of Smurfette syndrome? By the way, not a real Smurf. Gargamel made her. No joke, she sang four different songs. I had to change my pants three times. By the fourth, I just sat in it. I viewed it as some sort of penance for something horrible I am going to do in the future, like anally raping a dozen orphan infants in front of a school bus full of nuns while mainlining heroin and crapping on Dr. Martin Luther King's grave. She is awful. The only thing I got out of this was I totally misinterpreted The Shining. I thought all along Jack Nicholson was the bad guy. I bet you got a free belt and a doorknob if you bought the soundtrack. This begs the question, were Mork's pants spoiled? Love the show.
I just kept waiting for that to finish, but it kept going.
Yeah,
it was longer than my summaries.
I'm sorry, did he say it stand the test of time? I don't understand. Did it? All right, that does it for this week.
And he did get a Matt penis reference.
That's true. So threw in Matt's penis. That's
a plus for him.
Yeah, I had to think for a second what a winky was.
It's about 5'8", looking like Shelley Duvall.
Yeah. Not Matt's, but that's okay. But all right, that does it for this week's review of Popeye. Thanks again for joining us and listening to our little podcast. If you've had a good time, the fun doesn't have to stop here. You can follow us on Facebook at Lunchtime Movie Review or on Twitter at Lunchtime Movie. On either Facebook or Twitter, you can keep up on our written film reviews, news on upcoming films and Blu-ray releases, and information on upcoming podcasts on the MHM Podcast Network, including this show, Lunchtime Movie Review, Movie House Memories, The Number Two Review, Male Bonding, Sunday Seconds with the Duke, and Film School Hustlers?
Hustlers.
Hustlers. All right.
We just need to shorten that.
All right, whatever. It's your show. Additionally, you can follow us on all our little side projects. Chris hosts the Number Two Review podcast and apparently the Film School Hustlers, which can also be heard on the MHN Podcast Network. You can follow him on Twitter at Haley Creative. Shane writes regularly for SydneyUnleashed.com and is a contributor to CultRadioGoGo.com. You can follow him on Twitter at Movie_Analyst, where you can keep up on his film reviews and celebrity interviews. Finally, if you've enjoyed yourselves and you download us off either iTunes or Stitcher, make sure to rate our podcast on either one of those two platforms. And if you have a chance, write a short review of the podcast. Of course, we always like the reviews that are positive, but we appreciate any feedback that we can get from any listeners of the show. Well, that does it for this episode of Lunchtime Movie Review. Until next time, I'm Patrick.
I'm Chris.
I'm Shane.
And we got to get out of here right now, and you guys are invited.
This podcast is not endorsed by Warner Home Video and is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Popeye, all names and sounds of Popeye characters, and any other Popeye-related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Warner Home Video or their respective trademark and or copyright holders. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Lunchtime Movie Review, Movie House Memories, and Fuzzy Bunny Slippers Entertainment, LLC, unless otherwise noted.